Let's make caramel apples. They're the perfect treat for fall, and there's so much science behind caramel. Now, this recipe is going to seem really easy, and it's simple, but not necessarily easy. We'll walk through the basic recipe, then talk through the different trials we did to show you what details you need to pay attention to and how to troubleshoot. First, prepare your apples by washing them and then putting a popsicle stick in the middle of each one. You can go for a traditional with a Granny Smith apple or mix it up. Then make the caramel. Add sugar to a small saucepan and place over medium heat. Watch how the sugar changes over time. Swirl the pan pretty vigorously, like you see us doing here, to make sure it cooks evenly. And at first, you're going to think that nothing's going on for a solid minute, and then all of a sudden, you'll see tons of sugar crystals. So you need to be observant and patient. It may be tempting to want to use a spoon to stir this, but we found that swirling the pan is best for forming even sugar crystals. To really see how the sugar transforms, every 30 to 60 seconds or so, take a small spoonful of the sugar so you can get a sample and put it on a plate or parchment paper. Make sure you don't touch it if it sticks at all because it will be very hot. Here are the four main stages that you want to pay attention to because you can really see clear differences. First, we have the white granulated sugar, then it begins to clump, then it gets color as it's clumping. And then lastly, we have a thick golden syrup with the sugar fully dissolved. Once you've reached that final stage and you don't see any sugar crystals, they fully dissolved and you have a nice light golden syrup, you can add in the heavy cream. But make sure you do so really, really slowly and in really small amounts. Like seriously, look how slowly we're doing it. If you add in the heavy cream too quickly, the sugar will essentially seize and come together and clump, and it separates out from the heavy cream, and it's an awful mess. It requires a lot of whisking to save. It is salvageable, but it's just not an enjoyable process. So just be patient and add it in really slowly. Once you've added in all the heavy cream, let the mixture continue to heat over medium heat and stir occasionally with a whisk, specifically to make sure that the caramel mixture on the bottom and the sides of the pan don't get stuck and cook unevenly. You'll continue to heat this until you reach a temperature of 235 degrees Fahrenheit. This will take about 5-ish minutes. You'll find that the mixture stays at a steady temperature of about 220 degrees Fahrenheit for a long time. And then once it goes right above that, it'll move really, really quickly from those 220 degrees to 235 degrees. So we turned down the heat a little bit once we saw it reaching above 220 degrees so we could watch it really closely during those last moments. Once it reaches that temperature, remove the pan from the heat and let the caramel sit for about a minute or two until it cools down to 215 or 210 degrees Fahrenheit. After an embarrassingly large number of trials of dipping these apples, we found that doing it directly from the pot was actually the easiest. Just tilt the pot at an angle, then dip the apple also at an angle, and rotate twice to get two coatings. That was the perfect amount for us. You could do more. Don't suggest doing less. Then place it on parchment paper to let cool. Try to do this fairly quickly because as the caramel cools, it will get a little bit more challenging to coat the apple evenly. All right, obviously we went through a ton of trials, so we want to make sure that we share all the tips that we learned somewhat the hard way so you can learn in maybe an easier way, although you'll probably have to do a trial or two as well. That's just part of the process. So let's start off with what you should do before you even cook the caramel. First, you want a stainless steel pot because it's more even in terms of cooking. You also don't want to use a nonstick pan, that's actually not safe. The size of the pot also matters. If the pot is too small, the heavy cream will boil over and create a huge mess, and if it's too big, it will be hard to dip the apples into the caramel. So this recipe is for a 1.5 to 2 quart small sauce pot. Additionally, you want to have everything out so you're not running around or trying to grab something because things will happen really quickly. When actually making the caramel, use your senses, but you also don't want to underestimate the importance of a thermometer, especially once you've added in the heavy cream, because it's a little bit harder to use your senses to really see what point you're at and if the caramel is cooked to 230 degrees Fahrenheit, which again, we know sounds really specific, but take a look at these two apples. There's just a 5-degree difference between the two and they have totally different textures. Lastly, if you're having any issues with actually caramelizing the sugar before adding in the heavy cream, you can do the wet sugar method, which is adding in a little bit of water, which helps it cook a little bit more evenly. So, what's the science behind caramel? Well, first, let's talk about the sugar and how it transforms. Originally, we have the sugar, which is fairly flavorless other than just being sweet. It's colorless and it's odorless. And in the end, we have something that is totally different in terms of its color, texture, and flavor. And the reason behind that is caramelization, which isn't actually the process of making caramel, but a chemical reaction in which that sugar transforms due to heat. Looking at the chemical reaction in a little bit more detail, we see that we start off with sucrose, which is what white sugar is. Sucrose is a disaccharide, meaning it's two sugars bonded together. As we add heat, that bond breaks apart and we now have two single sugars, aka glucose and fructose. And then, as we get to even hotter temperatures, those sugars further break it down into smaller molecules called flavor molecules. And that's where we see all of those changes in color, texture, and flavor. There are tons of flavor molecules. These are just a few that we often see when making caramel. So this recipe primarily shows caramelization, that chemical reaction that changes the white sugar, but there are a couple other interesting pieces here. So first, let's talk about the science behind the ingredients. Now, compared to most caramels, this recipe is actually missing a key ingredient, butter. So why? Well, as you can see in this trial, the fat from the butter makes the caramel slide right off the apple. Now, we didn't want to give up on the butter quite yet because it's such a common ingredient in most caramels, so we tried cooking the caramel for a little bit longer to thicken it and see if that would help, but that resulted in a highly bitter, dark caramel that was teeth-shatteringly hard. So in place of butter, we have a lot of heavy cream, and that heavy cream is essential for giving the caramel its chewy, flexible texture. As we add in the heavy cream, we notice it immediately sizzles and bubbles, and that's due to a huge difference in temperature between the really cold heavy cream and the really hot sugar. The heavy cream is almost instantaneously brought up in temperature, and so we see those bubbles, which is actually water evaporating out of the heavy cream. And if you're wondering, wait, water? Well, about 50% of heavy cream is actually water. And that's why, once all the heavy cream is added, we have to continue to heat it to boil out all of the water, so we get that perfect texture that we want for the caramel. Now, water boils at 220 degrees Fahrenheit, or 100 degrees Celsius, and so that's why this will hover around that temperature for a really long time until all the water is boiled out, and then it'll really quickly go from 220 to 235 degrees. Now, right around that 235 degree Fahrenheit temperature, we have another chemical reaction that occurs, which is the Maillard reaction, which develops even more flavor molecules and is basically a reaction between the proteins in the milk and the sugar. You can learn more about that in our Brown Butter Rice Krispies video here. Now, the science behind the directions mainly shows us how the amount of heat that we add to the heavy cream and the sugar will impact the final texture and taste of the caramel greatly. If the sugar didn't cook evenly and properly, we had a grainy texture in which we could see some of the undissolved sugar crystals in the caramel. Similarly, if we overcook the final mixture of both the heavy cream and the sugar, we notice an overly dark and bitter sauce that almost has some burnt taste and looks broken, meaning it's not very smooth. Okay, hopefully now knowing the science behind caramel and seeing our troubleshooting and tips, you feel ready to go and making your own caramel. And if it doesn't go exactly the way that you had planned, just keep in mind that generally every single trial you do, you're learning something new. Thanks for tuning in. Like and subscribe for more videos.